Just recently, Dr. Turbor was recognized by an organization called Clarivate Analytics as being one of the world's most highly cited research scientists. And people are recognized by that list, I understand, by being in the top 1% of papers. And that goes over a period of 10 or 11 years. These are citations and also peer reviews. He is an internationally recognized expert on tropical ecology with nearly 300 peer-reviewed publications and 36,000 citations from fellow scientists. And this is one of the things I love about being in Cedar Key. We're all in the midst of the wonderfulness of each other. And I can't even imagine any place else anywhere near here where we could gather a group of this many people together and have people of the caliber that we have to visit our library in Cedar Key in the wintertime. And it just, it's probably my favorite part of being a librarian here. Dr. Turbord is the James B. Duke Professor Emeritus of Environmental Science at Duke. And he and Dr. Lisa Davenport are courtesy research scientists at the Florida Museum of Natural History and also in the Department of Biology. So we're so fortunate to have them here and also living in our community. So are you going to be first? John's going to be first? Okay. Dr. Turbor is an authority on avian and mammalian ecology in neotropical forests. He's been working on a field station in Peru, the Manu National Park field station, since 1973. Prior to being at Duke, he was on the faculty of the University of Maryland and also Princeton University. He's a MacArthur Fellow. It just goes on and on and on. And I'm not going to take up too much of his time, but he's going to enlighten us today about top predators in our midst. And then when Dr. Turbord is finished, Dr. Lisa Davenport is going to talk to us about some special otters in the Amazonian river valleys. And I asked her to describe to me how big these river otters were, and they're really big.
There you go.
Any of the otters we've seen around here, so I'm really excited to hear both of them. And if you have no questions or comments, everyone knows where the restroom is. Everyone's mm-hmm. cell phone is silenced, right? Okay. Also, I wanted to give a special thank you to, we have an AV guy now. That's Sid Hankin. So I wanted to give Sid a special thank you and recognition. We think that we're going to have no glitches this year, right, Sid? We're pretty sure that that's going to happen. We have figured out every possibility. So at least we thank you. So with that, Dr. Turbor, thank you.
Thank you all for turning out on this frigid day. We came from North Carolina hoping to escape this kind of weather. My wife and I moved here about 2 years ago. We haven't been here all that much, but this is our permanent home, and we're glad to be here and for the opportunity to get to know some of you folks. I've been doing research in South America for a long time, and recently we branched out and started doing research other places in Africa and Malaysia and Australia. And so this will cover the talk I'm going to give you today. It will cover several continents and develop a theme that's one of my favorite themes in science. I think it's one that involves all of us. It can be highly controversial, and the controversies are, like in some of other scientific areas, they're preventing us from looking at the problem rationally, calmly, and seeking solutions that will provide the best for all of us. Now, let's see. This came out in this morning's paper, and I saw it with some surprise. It's sensational what you think. Of course, what it is it's in Florida. It's taken on a golf course near Miami. It's an alligator. Well, that's a normal thing in Florida. But if you can see what the alligator is doing, he's having a life and death battle with a huge Burmese python. And it looks like the python's getting worse a bit because the head of the python is in the alligator's jaw. but it brings up a subject that I've been talking about quite a bit, and that is the subject of a super predator. A super predator is not a Tyrannosaurus Rex. It's a predator that is introduced into an environment where the potential prey have no prior experience with it, and their behavioral adjustments to predation are simply do not take into account this new animal, and so they're often extremely vulnerable. The Burmese python is one of these super predators. Escaped into the Everglades and has a huge population of them. And because the prey, all manner of prey, including even alligators, are naive about these ambush predators, they hide, they're almost invisible, they strike and passing animals. They don't have any defenses against this. And so the scientific data show that mammal populations, I'm talking raccoons, foxes, even bobcats, deer, the whole spectrum, have gone down 98% or 99% in the Everglades. It's Everglades almost free of any mammals now because of these things. And this is typical of what a super predator does. It comes in to a world in which all the prey are naive and it literally wipes them out. So this happened in the North American continent about 11,000 years ago when humans came. Humans are the world's greatest super predator. And before humans got to North America, the continent was occupied by creatures like this and many others. And the whole African savanna style of megafauna, of which these are the, you know, the kingpins, the charismatic ones, the Colombian mammoth, and the mastodon. And these animals were everywhere. The dots are localities where bones of mammoths or mastodons have been recovered, and you see they're from Florida up into Canada, where this was where the glaciers were, so this was mostly during glacial times. They were widespread all over the continent, but within a few hundred years after the arrival of Clovis Man, about 11,000 years ago, they were gone. They were gone, along with about 40 other large animals that lived in North America. Everything, the large peccaries and giant capybara and tapirs and horses and camels and all sorts of other things, they're all gone now. So humans were the super predator that really changed things in North America. So we're living in a very altered environment. We don't like to think of it that way, but if you consider what it was like before people, it was a very different place. Now, if you go to Africa, where the megafauna has in large part survived, then you can have some idea of how important these big animals are in the world they occupy. Elephants eat trees, and they can do enormous damage to individual trees, and though it looks like that thing is beyond repair. The fact is that the trees in Africa are adapted, or at least have a long history of being hammered that way. And as bleak as that look, this tree will recover. But sometimes the elephants can destroy a whole woodland, and that will recover, but it'll take a much longer time. But this just illustrates how profound impact that these large animals can be on the landscape and how different a world without them is. Now, we have now a shift of predators, which is really the main theme of this talk. And we have a very charismatic one here in Florida. This Florida panther is not my picture. I picked it up off of Google Images, I have to confess. But it's a nice picture of a Florida in a good Florida setting. So, this is a one of the animals that's controversial because the Fish and Wildlife some years ago was going to establish another population of Osceola National Forest, and lo and behold, they released 8 of them there, and they didn't stay where they wanted them to. And so they got scared because they thought somebody might complain, and they pulled them all off. And so the Florida panthers are south of the Coosahatchee River, and that's pretty much this one female north of it, but that's pretty much the way it is. But the point here is that we lost our megafauna in North America in 30 or 40 species of large mammals, but we didn't lose everything, because there are still some big animals. They're not elephants or camels or horses, but we have elk and moose and bison and some large predators go with it, including the Florida panther. I like to refer to them as pumas, and they're wolves. They're Mexican wolves and red wolves, and there's lynx and bobcats and grizzly bears. So we have a scattering of these large predators that are still present on the landscape and performing their ecological roles. Now, what happens when people persecute these things? A lot of other species react. So when there are predators present, let's imagine that they're pumas, then the deer density is maintained at a fairly low level, at a level that's so low or low enough that the deer are not doing conspicuous damage to the vegetation. But if on this line, if predators are removed at that point, well, then the deer will escape this demographic control and increase to much, much higher densities, often 10 times their prior density. And at that density, they begin to eat up, they go into what's called ecological overshoot, and they begin to eat the, not just the interest from the vegetation, begin to eat the capital itself. And so they really decrease the capacity of the vegetation to supply food, and that eventually forces them down to somewhat lower density, but still one that's much higher than the starting one. And so here, this is sort of anybody's guess at what the ecological integrity is. Well, a colleague of mine, Bill Ripple, who was at Oregon State, has done some excellent work on predator-prey relationships in national parks out west. So this is a slide that relates to Zion National Park in southern and southwestern Utah. If you've ever been there, there's Zion Canyon. This is a spectacular, beautiful place that attracts huge numbers of visitors in the summer. And so part of that park is the area that's accessible to visitors, and where, as I say, thousands of people come every summer. Pumas don't like the mix with people, and so they retreat up into some of the more remote canyons. So if you go up into the remote canyons, you'll find they're very good stands of cottonwoods. But around the areas visited by people, you see cottonwood stands that look like that. They're superannuated stands that have utterly no regeneration taking place. Here you see small cottonwoods. They're coming in. They're replacing the old ones, but here there's none of that. And so that's shown in these lower panels, where coring trees, you can tell how old they are. And so this is like any other population age structure. There are a few very old ones, quite a few middle-aged ones, even more young ones. That's the normal of what you expect of a healthy population that's replacing itself. But where the cougars are absent, the deer come in great numbers because they know the cougar is absent, so that's the place where the deer concentrate. The deer eat all the young saplings and seedlings, and so the age structure is restricted to very old individuals prior to 1940 when these changes began to take place. And so there's this missing age class here. There's no recruitment of aspen. This has impacts that carry all the way down to the geomorphology and stream characteristics, where they're low deer density. This is in Yellowstone. You can see there are there are willows and shrub covers, and dense vegetation right up to the riverbank. Same thing is true in Zion, but where the deer density is high, the vegetation is simply eaten off the riverbanks. Banks begin to erode. Here you can see the eroding bank. Eventually, gravel bars take place of where there used to be a bank. The stream widens. The water is more exposed to sun. It gets warmer. This is not good for the trout, so the aquatic biology begins to change. All these things happen because there either is or isn't a top predator in the system. It carries the smaller organisms too. And this is again Zion, where cougars are common. Then you have a healthy ecosystem with lots of wildflowers, amphibians, lizards, butterflies in areas where cougars are absent and there are too many deer. Well, then there's no wildflowers, almost no amphibians, a few lizards and butterflies, but greatly reduced numbers. So this is what's called a trophic cascade. If you remove one functional level from the food chain, then all the other levels begin to respond. The responses are not always ones that we would prefer to have. This is a some more examples of this. This is a an enclosure in a park in Wisconsin. And you can see where it's fenced off and the deer can't get in. It's just crowded with tree seedlings. They're more dense than they really ought to be. But outside, where the deer are extraordinarily abundant, there's simply no broadleaf plants, not even herbs, wildflowers, and tree seedlings. All of that's gone, and what there is instead is grass, because deer don't have the right kind of dentition to eat grass. They tend to avoid it. And so the net result, if you wait long enough, is that all the trees will die and fall over, and they won't be replaced. And the deer will, in effect, over time, create a grassland out of a forest, which is a pretty radical transition. But this is what is happening in some part. Now, the same processes are not restricted to Western national parks. These are scenes of early spring in the Great Smoky Mountain National Park, and these wildflower displays there, some of the most wonderful and beautiful manifestations in nature you can see anywhere in the U.S. They're really, truly wonderful, and let's hope they can stay that way. But if you go to Shenandoah National Park, which is much narrower and has a very large deer population, instead of all those nice wildflowers, what do you have? You have a monoculture of something called the hay-scented fern, and it's the one plant that the deer can't eat. It's poisonous, they can't eat it, and so that's the only thing you have. All these nice wildflowers are gone. So this is interactions that start with predators and go through herbivores and eventually wind up changing vegetation have all sorts of consequences for us in various ways. Now, when I grew up, I lived in Virginia. I grew up in Virginia, and this was one of the commonest birds. You couldn't go outside for an hour without running into bobwhite quail. When I go back to that part of the country, there aren't any quail anymore. Whippoorwills have gone. Worm-eating warblers, the black and white warblers. A lot of these things that nest on the ground are gone because there are too many intermediate-sized mammals that are like foxes and raccoons and opossums and now increasingly feral house cats that are not controlled by higher levels of predators. So they're wreaking havoc on the animal community. It's not, these effects are not restricted to the plant community. So that's all I'm going to say about North America. I've got a little bit of time. I want to talk a bit about Australia. Lisa and I spent quite a bit of time there. We were there for 8 months in 2015-16, where we're associated with James Cook University in Cairns. It's way up here. And we've gotten interested in some of the things that are happening in Australia. Now, the situation in Australia is somewhat different from what I've just described to you in North America. This is a recreation of Australia before it lost its megafauna. Now, people have been in Australia much longer than in North America. They arrived in North America about 14,000. They keep finding it's a little older than they thought it was before. But the animals disappeared about 11,000 years ago when the new technology arrived called the Clovis Point. In Australia, people were there 50,000 years ago, maybe 75,000 years ago. The animals disappeared around 40,000, but again, it happened very, very quickly. And so this is a representation of what Australia would have been like before people. And they were, as in North America, they were herbivores that are now extinct, these big ostrich-like birds, these diprotodonts, big heavy mammals, the biggest things that there were no, these are all marsupials that you have placental mammals there, these short-faced browsing kangaroos, about 20 species of those, they're all extinct now. And they had their roster of top predators, the most fearsome of which, an animal I dread to meet, if ever there were still any in the world, that's a thing called Megalania. It's a monitor lizard, 5 meters long. You've heard of the Komodo dragon, which is can be a dangerous animal. That's 3 meters long. Imagine one that's 5 meters, as big as the largest alligator. Those are formidable animals. And this is Thylacoleo, the so-called marsupial lion. And then here's the Thylacine, the Tasmanian wolf or Tasmanian tiger. Well, these were the top predators in Australia. And along with the big herbivores, 54 species of them in all, disappeared with the onslaught of humans. But the difference is that in Australia, there weren't any big predators after that. They just all disappeared. Whereas I mentioned, you know, we still got pumas, we still got wolves, and still got grizzly bears. There's some top predators to keep the lid on things here in North America, but that didn't happen in Australia. And so things really went bad in Australia. The surviving animals, this is the largest, the red kangaroo, weighs maybe a couple hundred pounds, big male. That's the largest surviving animal in Australia. This is the wallaroo, it's a little bit smaller. There's still a large herbivorous bird, the emu. But in the absence of any regulation, they can overgraze the environment and create just a god-awful situation of erosion like that. So that's one thing that happened. The herbivores have no top-down regulation. They explode in abundance, and then they can destroy the vegetation. And then something else happened. Europeans arrived, and Europeans brought with them some predators that had never been in Australia before. For one, foxes were introduced about 1830 to support a fox hunting pastime for the homesick Britons who were in Australia. Well, that was a disaster. Also, people brought their cats, and very soon they escaped. And so foxes and cats have been a plague in Australia. And between 1850 and about 1960, in addition to the 54 large animals that gone extinct historically 40,000 years ago, another 27 more modest-sized animals went extinct between 1850 and 1960, just a huge wave of extinctions that were, it's well agreed with virtually all the experts saying the same thing, that it was foxes that wiped them out. Again, here's a fox, a super predator, and it's eliminating its prey. Now, here's some of the ones that still survive. Most of them survive in the north. Their foxes live only in the south. The tropics is not congenial to them. I can't tell you why, but they're confined in the southern half of Australia. And so some of the animals still survive in the north. This is a thing called the bilby. This is the numbat. This is the betong. And this is the doily. They're very strange little animals. They're all marsupials. We're not used to animals like this. They may all look like rats, but they're not rats in what they do. They do a great variety of different things. Some of them look like flying squirrels, and others look like mice. They're extremely varied, and there are literally 200 or 300 species of them, all sorts of different things, filling a vast array of ecological niches. But they're becoming extremely scarce, and the Australians are putting huge effort, I will say, putting a huge effort into saving their endangered mammals. So now Australia has three sort of meso predators, middle-sized predators. Here's the fox, and the pale blue there is absent. So it's absent in north. It's confined to the south. These are not very consistently obtained data, because you can see it's all red here, and I've just crossed the border into the state of New South Wales, and the color changes. What I mean is they use different methods to get the results, and so there's inconsistencies here. Then the cat is everywhere, and some of them get pretty big, you see. The cats are everywhere, and they're a huge problem now. And then there's this creature, the dingo, which is classified as an ordinary dog. Canis familiaris dingo is the name of this thing. The dingo is unusual because it wasn't in Australia originally. It's a placental mammal. It is a dog, and so the evidence now indicates it arrived about 4,000 years ago, way before historical times, so long after people were in Australia, and it apparently came with a wave of colonization of humans. They had to come through New Guinea. There's some very old breeds of dogs in New Guinea, so this must have been how the dingo arrived. Well, now it's thoroughly established as a wild animal. Nobody keeps dingoes. I've never seen one as a pet. But if you go to the outback parts of Australia, yes, you can see dingoes. So we've seen quite a bit. So, but what you can say is the dingo isn't the problem. It's clear as heck that the dingo isn't the problem. It's been there for 4,000 years. Every animal that is endangered now or went extinct in that way from 1860 to 1850 to 1960 had lived for thousands of years with the dingo. The dingo isn't the problem. The fox and the cat are the problem. And so now you have to concern yourself about what is the interaction between dingoes and foxes and cats, because that becomes a very critical part of the picture. But I'll just mention that the Australians hate dingoes the way Western ranchers in this country hate wolves. They really hate dingoes, because dingoes like to eat sheep. Normally they eat kangaroos, and they're very good at eating kangaroos, but where there's sheep, they will get sheep. So what you see here is a fence. That is the dog fence. You won't believe this number, but the Australians built that fence. It goes for 5,000 kilometers. 5,000 kilometers. And they maintain that fence. On this side, there are dingoes. On that side, there aren't any dingoes. On this side, they raise cattle. On that side, they raise sheep. You can only raise sheep where there are no dingoes. But 5,000 kilometers fence. Pretty impressive. Cats are not contained by that fence. They're just everywhere, and if there's a bush-tailed possum, you see they take their toll on native mammals. Now, here's some research that was done in California with friends of mine, and it has to do with the role of coyotes in regulating cats and what cats do to the smaller members of the native wildlife. Cats, when they become feral, they hunt everything that's out there that's of appropriate size. They eat lizards, frogs, squirrels, birds, rabbits, rats. And they can be devastatingly effective. Often the people take pity on them and subsidize them with food. I know that's happening right here on CP. It happens in lots of other places, so the cats are maintained by subsidies at much higher densities than they could ever maintain in a purely wild condition, and so they have really massive effects on these lesser components of the wildlife. Well, where coyotes are in the picture, coyotes have a special dislike for cats, or like, you could say, because they eat them, but they really grow for cats. And where there are coyotes, you better keep your cat indoors, because the coyotes attack it straight away. And then you have, with coyotes, you have healthy populations of all these things. When you have feral cats and no coyotes, then lots of these things just quickly disappear. So it's pretty cut and dry. Now, this is the punchline, the end of the story. What are the Australians doing to preserve their scarce native mammals? There's another 17 of them, they say, they're highly endangered now. Well, here's what they do. They build these predator-proof fences. These are fences that are very expensive to build. As you can see, they're very elaborate, high quality and high, and they have to be various sizes of mesh. They're trying to keep rats out. They have to have overhangs so the rats can't climb around and over. They keep out cats, they keep out foxes, they keep out, I say, rats. And yes, if you build miles and miles of fences like that and then have an extermination campaign in the middle, get rid of all cats, foxes, rats, everything, it's very expensive. And then seal it off, and then you put your native mammals, they'll do fine. Yes, they do. But how much can you do that? And moreover, it's not very sustainable, because those fences are extremely expensive. A storm or falling tree can knock them down, and then predators can go in. So I think it's a stopgap measure. It works, demonstrably works, but it's very expensive and it's very hard to sustain for in perpetuity. Whereas here's a dingo, they come in various colors. This dingo, if it acts like coyotes do in North America, it can do the job for it. The trouble is that they just hate the dingoes so much. They can't bear to just let them do their job. And we have the same problem with wolves in the West. So we share that common problem. And it's up to all of us to figure out what kind of a solution we want, because it's in the end, it's a political problem. It's not just a biological, it's a political problem. So the answers are political, but science isn't. So we do share some of these same issues with the Australians, and maybe someday we'll have the answers we'd like to have. So thanks a lot.